Yeah. Anyway, go ahead, John.
Go ahead, John.
So just a little background. I'm a big Kenneth Lonergan fan ever since You Can Count on Me, which is definitely one in my top five, if not maybe top 10, but probably top five all-time favorite films. And that came out in 2000, and I just loved it. I fell in love with that movie. So I kind of was following Ken Lonergan, like, what's he going to do? What's he going to do? What's he going to do? When's his next movie coming out? And Margaret was shot in 2005. It was supposed to come out in 2005. But Fox Searchlight wanted him to cut it to no more than 150 minutes, 2 hours 30. They're like, you can't go over. And he couldn't do it. He couldn't do it. He tried and he tried. And it was like months turned into years. And he couldn't get a cut that would get to that number. He had a 3-hour cut. And they were like, absolutely not. We're not going to release a 3-hour movie. So there was actually like 2 or 3 lawsuits. At one point, Martin Scorsese and Thelma Schoonmaker came in and cut their version of it, which never got released. And ultimately, in 2012, I guess it was, he got his 3-hour and 5-minute director's cut. But there was a release that was the one that he didn't like, that was 2 hours 30. And that came out, but just barely. They dumped it. It like played New York and L.A., and I think then they pushed, there was a sort of an outcry from fans and they pushed it into a few more screens. It played in San Francisco and I drove down to San Francisco to go see it.
The 3-hour. So you've seen both versions.
No, I drove down to see the 2-hour and 30-minute version because that was the only one at that point in 2011. So I drove down to see that. And then there was like a New Yorker article about it in the New York Times. And it was everywhere about all that, you know, what happened to Kenneth Lonergan's Margaret. And eventually, you know, there was so much talk about it that they released this other one. And you can get it, like, I think when you buy the disc, you get the theatrical cut, and then you also get this version that we all watched.
I don't think there's an HD master of the 3-hour.
Oh, no, there was definitely DVD quality.
This was seriously upscaled.
Yeah, it was, the credits are nice and sharp, but the rest of the film was that kind of soft 480 look.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't too bad. It wasn't too bad, but it was definitely...
not the kind of story that suffers from being low def, but...
I mean, I was going to say one thing about it. It's like, for a New York movie, this wasn't a, you know, New York, look how beautiful New York is kind of film. It was just like, yeah, we live here, and we're kind of all...
If New York is synonymous with the Upper West Side.
Yeah, right.
Scott is quarter on the machine for this one. I will just say that this was when you picked this, I was like, oh God, here, because I find Manchester by the Sea is one of those movies I never want to see again, even though I thought it was a good movie. Fucking torturesome. And I saw this the synopsis in like 3 hours of more tragedy. Great. Mm-hmm. And I started it at like 8:45 on a Wednesday. I had to force myself to stop watching it after 2 and change.
Wow. Because
despite everything, I was kind of sucked in. Shockingly, I thought this was going to be a 3-nighter.
Yeah. So the spirit was willing, but the flesh was weak and you had to go to bed.
Spirit was willing. I was like, it's like 11 something and I got to go to bed.
Right. Yeah.
I probably could have done this whole movie in one sitting.
I didn't have a problem with it. I was surprised too. I did watch it in one sitting. I've had never seen the 3-hour cut before.
I'm kicking Scott out of the way because I'm on a roll. Let him shit all over it in a second.
Okay.
This was a movie I expected to really dislike, and I do think it is a hot mess. But despite the fact that I think after 3 hours. The moral of the story is life isn't fair. there are things about this movie that really I thought were sort of remarkable. And this is, again, I'm interested to hear what Tad has to say about it. Because while I did not live in New York, I've been there a lot. This was one of the first movies that I felt like they really tried to give you a sense of what it is like to live with umpteen million people right on top of you at all times. The fact that he would let the dialogue bleed in from the other tables at the cafes and restaurants and the other apartments when they were in, and they really like apartment living, like you're sitting around a little table and your kitchen's barely big enough to cook your food in. Even for the folks, I think, living on the Upper West Side, the coughing in the opera scenes.
Yes.
I was like, that I've never heard that before, but I've been to enough plays, et cetera. And like, yeah, like you hear the audience. And like, this was a movie that was very big on letting you hear everybody that's in New York.
The throng.
All the time, which I thought
was I did like that gimmick in terms of, well, it was the way it was mixed it, because there are a lot of conversations in restaurants where you hear other dialogue going on and not just snippets of blah, blah, blah. It's like, you almost want to listen
to the whole thing.
To another one.
Yeah.
Because what's going on there is fascinating. And it happens over and over again in this thing. And that was a really neat thing.
It made New York feel like a very living place.
Now, that's the thing. This is, again, I'm kind of glad Tad's not here, but this is Auditorium Maison-Scène.
Sure. Yes.
Right? Oh, God damn it.
Okay. So then I'll just say that I thought there were individual scenes that were really quite something. I mean, the death scene that kicks this movie off,
yeah,
I'm going to have a hard time unseeing, because that was really remarkable.
Quite and realistic, man.
Horrible and traumatic all at the same time.
Yeah.
There were...
Alice and Janney showed up for work that day.
Yeah, man. Did she ever. Wow. but I actually think that a lot of the people in this movie showed up for work. And that their individual scenes, I thought they were really well acted and well written. And I'm sure Scott will get to this, but... at the end of all of it, even while I found the last scene of the movie pretty powerful in its own way, you kind of, by the time you get all the way to the end, you're like, and what did all this mean? Is this a slice of life? Are you trying to say something about tragedy and mourning and regret? I felt like he kind of lost the plot, trying to tell this really big story around this very small set of characters. And I'm not entirely sure he was successful, even though I would recommend it for everything else that I said.
Right.
Great.
Well, he did shoot, I
don't disagree with anything you said. And I don't, you know, I won't express my feelings on it yet, because I know Scott's chomping at the bit.
I'm very interested in hearing what the difference, the halfway now, extra half
mind you, was. You know, you think I'm going to like lay into this thing and have some huge brickbats. That's true and it's not true.
Okay.
The thing is, you know, I got sucked into the story too, because it is realistic and fascinating. It's someone trying to get someone, you know, thrown out of be fired for being a bad bus driver or whatever, and going through this stuff. And you see where her idea of justice, immature, childish notion of justice, goes against nothing. And it's like, yeah, well, you don't matter. You're just you're even though you were there and you saw her dying, she died in your arms. You're just a sightseer here. The money's
no one's on her side.
No one's on her side. No, at any time. And
if they are, she turns them against them, against her.
But God,
for good reason, she's an asshole.
No, goddamn, this movie is about the most unlikable.
On purpose.
I don't like films about unlikable people.
They wrote a very unlikable character for her, and she played it very unlikably.
But
she plays like the Matt Damon character. She's playing everybody, and she is totally a representative of like the Zoomer mentality.
I got teenage nieces. There's nothing in her performance that I don't see in real life.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, so that's the thing. As part of it, it's like, oh well, you know, that's, she's being a teenager. The thing is, take this into a social milieu, socioeconomic milieu, where it is the upper, was the Upper West Side, right? These people are all just obscenely rich. They don't have to, you know, nobody here has to have a job. And, you know, and everybody's just kind of like, just like doing lunch and spending their time. She's going to a very expensive school, and, you know, mom's an actor and dad's a director, and she's going to have her entire life in front of her paved and set with gold, you know, gold and diamonds. So she's got no real worries. And when this thing happens to her, mostly it's about addressing her own grief and addressing something bad she saw she can't get out of her head anymore.
And her own guilt.
She lies.
Is it really? It's more her guilt.
It's guilt.
Oh, yeah, I guess so. You know,
because it's always about her.
Yeah.
It is always about her. And what, you know, the thing is, at the end, she confessed, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah. And it's almost offhand, and it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. At that point, it doesn't matter at all. You know, no one's going to go after her. You know, it doesn't change a thing. And so that was kind of interesting. But just something about having to sit through 3 hours of watching this world unspool enraged me, because I just don't need to know or see about these people at all. There's nothing. It's, you call me a communist, but I just want to, every scene, I want to burn the fucking place down, man.
Is it just every a class thing? It's like you don't.
It is. I'm fessing up. This is a class thing. I just don't.
Need pairs of the rich or the upper middle
stories class. About these people. I just don't.
It's just that he's anti-Semitic.
But hold on.
Nice.
I've seen most, if not all, the Woodies, the Woody Allen movies. Oh. And we all know what kind of New York movie Woody likes to make.
Right.
Which is, people like this, but like, you don't see anything dirty. You don't see anything unpleasant about living in a city. Like, it's only the good stuff, like the great restaurants. I'm going to go eat at Elaine's or this fabulous cafe, etc. This was like the flip side of that.
Yeah, totally.
Dude, this is also a film that you can imagine Woody Allen getting a print of and jerking off the entire 3 hours.
Oh, I don't.
Come on. It's like he would approve entirely of a story by a teenage girl from the Upper West Side. You know that, right?
Well, yeah. He'd like it because she's a teenage girl.
That's exactly right.
I don't think he'd like it for the story.
But he'd also like it because it is his brand of storytelling in terms of about, it's a talk, it's a conversation about there are no ethics, about there are, we make our own rules of life.
But stylistically, it's
take crimes and misdemeanors, for example.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm talking about. He visits themes to
this,
say that
this would be a good right double bill.
Exactly, yeah, right. Exactly.
But it's totally different in that I don't think the Martin Landau character has the same kind of guilt that she does. At least her guilt is authentic.
The opposite.
Very visceral, that's for sure. But
I was just going to say, there's a phrase, I read an interview with Kenneth Lonergan, and he said there was a phrase that he and who's the lead actor, Anna Paquin, would say, like, before takes, is like, bone-crushing reality. You never get bone-crushing reality, even in Crimes and Misdemeanors, you never get bone-crushing reality from a Woody Allen film. You know what I mean? There's always this sort of artistic frame around what he's painting, even if it's
a little Brecht.
This actually was pretty vivid in that respect, because Anna Paquin did her thing and did it well. Although her physical presence, she's just kind of this big lumpy mixed Midwesterner and all these beautiful people. You know, it was a slight miscasting. She kind of comes off like a big lug, visually speaking, in all the scenes, because everybody else looks so sophisticated and thin and
her one bra strap.
Yeah, I don't know.
Featured in most of the shots.
This is just my perception. Just like she's a little too, not quite the right look for that role. Hmm. Did a great job. She acted well and it did a good job all the way through. But it's just very strange. I kept my finger on it exactly. But
I thought the best one was Monica's friend. Emily.
Yeah.
Holy
yeah.
shit.
Where she tears her a new asshole. I was like, okay, I'm with you, lady.
Yeah. That's terrifying. That is the way she turns on her is just so, I mean,
just like that.
Look, and it's shocking to Lisa in the movie, and it's shocking as a viewer. You're just like,
right. Whoa. You're like, whoa, nobody, we're gonna really do some sort of
Well, that woman is pretty scary in that movie. I mean, the way she had that scene with the lawyer, they're sitting out in the cafe, and she insults him
several times.
But she totally means the insult that she gives him, and then she totally condescends to him and kind of touches his face. It's like, I knew you were a kid, and it's just like,
It's that, and it's Jean Reno's anti-Semitic remark that he tries to live past.
Which was kind of Anna Paquin's character's fault. She had that experience earlier, and she kept talking about it and talking about it and kept bringing the conversation until eventually this poor Jean Reno character had tripped over his perceptions and fucked everything up. That was her doing it. Accidentally.
Right, but she basically brought the argument from her classroom to that restaurant table.
Because she didn't win against
then she blew up her
Palestinian apology.
He died.
There was at least four storylines here that have nothing to do with the central arc, which is getting the bus driver fired.
Right.
And so I guess I'll ask John, the 2.5 hour version, was it any of those?
I watched the 2.5 hour version by mistake.
Shots of the New York City skyline put back in.
Well, you know what? There were definitely more shots of the New York City skyline, those slow pans with the opera music. I'm sure those got nipped in the, I haven't seen the shorter version since it came out in 11. But I would say those, and I think that whole drama class scene where they sat on the box and said their truths to each other, and she was rehearsing, she was doing tech rehearsal with them and stuff. I think that got lifted out. As far as what else got taken out, I'm not sure, because the Jean Reno plot with dating her mom was in there.
You could lift that entire thing out, and you'd probably get to
you could pull that out.
You see, that's the biggest, like, you know, tits on a battleship.
Time waster.
You could pull the Culkin kid out.
I watched the shorter version.
Yeah, what did you see was different, or did you watch the 3 hour?
I haven't watched the. Yeah, I forgot that it was on Criterion Channel, and I paid to watch it.
Damn it.
On Amazon, and I'm still pissed.
Yeah,
but I will probably go. I will probably go and watch it just to see. Yeah. All the Jean Reno stuff seems to be intact. I mean, I don't know what they cut out. There were a lot of panning scenes,
which I actually liked. That was very relaxing.
I thought they were nice.
Really, kind of, and more than even like the mise-en-scène audio, it kind of brought you into what this part of New York feels like.
And it's, so I was, it's okay, really weird because Judith has a friend who. They live in France part of the year and in Panama, but they're originally from like Philly, but now they live in New York and they live in the Upper West Side. Mm-hmm. And it was like the guy posted a picture right after I watched this movie of those twin towers.
Right.
You know, which is either the San Remo or the El Dorado. I'm not sure. They're both the same architect and they're both on the West Side, right. Upper West Side. But it was interesting because, you know, it was just like, oh my God.
Right, you had just been there.
Yeah.
You know what? The thing is about those pans and the other shots of the city, long lenses, the lighting was pretty flat. They weren't gorgeous. It was never beautiful. Oh, look at beautiful New York. Even those long pans were kind of grubby looking.
The one shot they had that seemed like a gratuitous New York thing was, I'm assuming it's the George Washington Bridge behind her as she's walking from the subway station.
The dude lives in Bay Ridge. That's the Verrazano Narrows Bridge.
Is that the okay? Yeah, okay. I knew it wasn't the Brooklyn Bridge.
They went.
It was still the place her out of.
There's visual language in this scene where she goes into Bay Ridge to go confront the bus driver, you know,
Mark
Ruffalo.
She's kind of walked around like this because it's like so not the Upper West Side. Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah, you know, it's so weird.
It was a field trip for her, you know.
It was like
an ethnographic study.
Pretty much. It's like Darkest Africa or something.
But
like
so much of this was for her a journey that way because she'd never been inside this. I'm quoting from the Lonergan interview again. She'd never been inside a police station before. She'd never seen a woman get run over by a bus before. She'd never gone to wherever Brooklyn, where bus driver lived.
Yeah, Brooklyn.
She's never
very south corner of it, yeah.
She went to a lot of places she'd never been, you know.
But okay, the very last scene when the opera was going, that was Hoffman, right? What do you think it meant? Her reaction to it. How did her reaction affect was affected by the rest of? Was it remorse? Was it guilt? Was it something else? What do you think?
I think it was relief.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, at the end, I'm kind of with Jim. Like, basically, she gets to the end of this hero's journey, complete failure on every level. Right. Like if you think about it, she doesn't get anything that she wants.
Right.
She doesn't get
mad. Which is good, I think. It's bad for, you know, the lady who got run over by a bus, but.
Like they lost the case. The guy didn't get, like
they saw him that night driving his bus.
Everything, a complete and total failure.
Yeah.
And I don't know, at the end of the day, like the only one she's got is the one that's kind of been trying to stand by her the entire time, which is her mom. Mm-hmm.
And even then, it was kind of so-so.
Listen, you go to the opera, you get emotional because it's beautiful sometimes. And like, if that was the thing that literally just flipped the switch on the crying, but it like a big aha moment, it's you and it's her.
Right.
And that's it.
This is the only person that matters. This is the only person that cares.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, yes. I'm with Jim on this one, and that scene represented kind of like, well, everything that happened before didn't work. Everything crashed and burned. At least, and it's like almost saying, at least I've got money and I can go to the opera and see beautiful things and be surrounded by beautiful people. And, you know, Renee Fleming was great in that too. She's one of my favorites opera singers. But that's like the thing was like, yeah, oh, I can always retreat into my fortress with cash. And that was, yeah, that was a lesson.
Are we sure that they have that level? The dad has the money. Mom and the daughter.
Jean Reno bought those tickets.
Yeah. Right, did they have the money? I don't know.
Actually, I
don't.
I like that.
Right, and I think she's living in their ex apartment on the Upper West.
No, these guys, nobody has to worry about cash. That's just
well, yeah, that's true, Scott. And surely, if this was a story of someone of a different economic strata,
I think she wouldn't
end at the Opera House in New York.
But the thing is, one thing that makes it complete though is that at the beginning, the mom didn't appreciate, like, or want to be at an opera. Yeah, remember that the first time? It's like, I don't know what's going on. I don't care. I don't ever do these things. I'm an actor, you know, like a stage actor. But at the end, maybe out of her own guilt.
Right, because she's off Broadway, Hoffman, right?
But maybe she has a real appreciation for it now. Maybe she really loves opera. And this is, you know, she's growing as a person. You know what I mean?
I just think she's growing into her position in society.
Yeah, pretty much. That's, yeah. If it was made 75 years ago, it should be ready for a cotillion or whatever it is, right?
Right.
That's a really interesting observation that it's a hero's journey. It's a hero's journey where the hero utterly fails.
Fails.
And that alone makes this movie pretty interesting, you know?
Yeah. Oh, it's definitely interesting. And I disagree with Tad. It's not too long.
Wait, give us
we already know he's going to say that, right?
He's a hero without any of the tools that heroes need to succeed. Because
self-awareness.
Indiana Jones knows what he's going for. If you went in there, it's like, I just want to find something. I don't know why I need it. You're never going to find it, right? And there it is.
Let me read another little bit from the interview, which is that Kenneth Lonergan said, except for a few exceptional people in the world, most people, as they mature, learn that the world is too big to have it improved or affected by you.
Right. That's
wonderfully hopeless.
Right. That's the few exceptions. Most of us learn that we can't make a huge impact on the world.
Most of us resign ourselves to the fact that we won't have a big impact.
Correct. And that's growth for her. That's what she has to learn. I get the feeling that it's like, even though she's just terrible wall to wall in this movie. You know what I mean? She's terrible to everybody around her, including her mom. I also get the feeling that she's got enough going on upstairs that in 10 years or 15 years, she's going to curl her toes thinking about how awful she was.
Agree.
During this period in her life.
Or it'll just wash over her and she'll ignore it.
And she'll be the same.
No, I think she has self-awareness. I can't remember who the line was.
I think she can become Monica's friend.
But I was going to say that.
Matt Damon, where she actually acknowledges that she's a privileged Jew from the West Side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
Who does she say that line to? Was it Matt Damon?
I think so.
Yeah.
She knows.
That before or after she tries to implicate him as her the father of her child?
That is a great scene
when she looks at the film,
I just love the other teacher who's with him.
Yeah,
do you need a minute?
And Matt Damon is just cool as a cucumber. He's just like, well, let's hear it. What do you have to say?
What is it about?
She folds. It's great.
Yeah,
she folds.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. Well, he walks in there and shows his Midwestern credentials like a calling card. Like, I'm decent, regular guy. Let's see what you do. And he does, and she does it. You know.
What about the scene with Ferris Bueller there, tearing the kid a new asshole? The kid's
insight was
just as valid as his. I thought.
No, he made a good point
about the flies intellect and
the flies.
That was
something, man. But I think we've all been in that classroom with that.
Yes.
Kid that won't stop, even though he's wrong. He just keeps doubling down.
But also, I've had teachers like that too. It's like, yeah, I know you're right, but I'm going to shut you up anyway because I'm
not. While I'm eating my sandwich and drinking my orange juice.
Exactly, that's good stuff.
We were just talking.
Also, this film totally sucked the day player crack.
Well, because the kids aren't being paid to be there, right? They're just forced to be there
but someone's paying a lot of money for those kids to be there.
Yeah.
but see, here's the thing. I think in this instance, it's her dad. It's not the mom paying for the tuition.
Yeah.
So I don't, like I said, I don't know that the mom.
I'm sure it's the father paying for everything. Yeah. But
we were just talking like last week or the week before about when we were talking about Zardoz, like every once in a while, the director gets to make the movie that they've been wanting to make. And they end up like making like some clusterfuck that here we go. Example four. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I don't know that it was 100% successful, but damned if I wasn't engaged.
Yeah,
if this is his Heaven's Gate, it's a pretty good one.
No, he is right. But also, he filmed it.
Heaven's Gate is not that bad a movie.
Right. Also, like Zardoz, he filmed it in his neighborhood with.
It's a good pick. Yes, that'd be a good pick, Jim.
Yeah, he went to he went to high school or whatever with Matt Damon. He knew him from a long time ago. They're old friends.
Yeah, he's real good pals with Damon, and also
Matthew Broderick. Right,
Matthew Broderick is like his best friend. Yeah, yeah.
Well, it's a lot of money to finish it together.
Matthew Broderick lives in one of those buildings that they
showed. I have no doubt. Yeah. I have no doubt.
Yeah, he said in the interview that they were super trying to be accurate. When somebody walks down, you know, with 57th Street and they turn right, they're going to be on the correct street when they do.
The geography was pretty good in this.
They didn't make anything up. Yeah. You know? And they used buildings. So it's like her school's three blocks from her house.
Right.
Yeah. Literally in New York.
Yeah. Well,
so all right, Tad Wright.
Go ahead. What's his statement?
Let's hear it, Tad.
Okay, hold on. Let me move it over here so I can read it.
All right, get your vape pen out.
And get my glasses.
Headphones on.
My takes will be brief as I don't have a lot of energy. Margaret, good acting, too long by an hour. If you take a New York MTA bus and you are only become party to a negligent homicide, count yourself lucky.
That's it. That's all he had to say.
Yeah.
we saw him. He wasn't feeling very well.
No. I expected.
He's at death's door. Okay.
Yeah, so, yeah. Are we do thumbs yet? Do we thumbs?
I mean, like I said, I don't. I could have watched this whole thing in one sitting, and for a 3-hour movie, that's saying something.
Yeah. I was compelled by the story. I sat through it. I would never want to see this film ever again. And I don't think I was really aimed to me, and it just made me angry. But I did see it.
I was pissed with the actress or the character that the actress played, but such is life.